In the deep hinterlands of Chitradurga Taluk or district, I was asked this question, that if you were to submit an Aadhaar card to your bank, how long would you take and how much would it cost you? I said, assuming that I have no printer at home, it's going to take me 2 minutes to dart down the road opposite my house. There's a photocopy shop, 50 paisa for the photocopy, 2 minutes back home, 5 minutes and 50 paisa. This friend of mine in that village told me, the equivalent for me is 310 rupees and 6 hours. I said, how? He says, listen, the photocopy shop is 20 kilometers away from my village. To get there, I need to catch a bus. The bus comes once in an hour. If I miss it, it's gone, right? So let's assume that it takes me an hour, hour and a half to get there. The photocopy cost is 20 rupees, right? And when I land up, either the power is not there or the guy who's running the photocopy shop has gone out to do something else, or I end up waiting for another hour or so. And I track back the same route, the same journey, bus in an hour. So if I leave home at 9, I'm back at 1:30. And I would have spent 20 rupees on the photocopy, 20 rupees each on the travel, and have lost half day of my wages. That's 150 bucks. That shook me, and that incident, that narrative stays with me because we take access so much for granted living in the cities. Right? There's another story of another friend called Praveen, who's all of 26 years old, lives in this village called Sanenahalli in Hasad. Praveen completed his 10th standard from Sanenahalli High School, moved to Hasan to do his ITI in electrical, came to Pinya, worked in some manufacturing setup, earning barely 8,000-9,000 rupees a month, struggled to make both ends meet because you can't survive in Bangalore at 8,000-9,000 rupees, somehow managed to stay afloat for 4-5 years, but he was always trying to figure out what next. Turns out that this manufacturing entity, the neighboring shop, was a printing press, and he used to print stickers, you know, these peelable stickers. So this guy says, in the evenings, I used to just go and hang out in that shop, and I learned how to print those stickers. He took a plunge 3 years ago, saying, I'm going to go back to my village and do the only thing I know, which is to print stickers. So smack in the middle of Sanenahalli, which is a population of 2,500 people, he borrowed 20,000 rupees from his friends and family, bought a second-hand Chinese sticker printing machine, and put up a sticker printing shop in the middle of nowhere. Now, who gives him business? He says, for the first few months, I barely got 5 orders, 10 orders. Each order is 20 bucks, 30 bucks, so I ended up making some 500 rupees, 1,000. I was continuously trying to figure out what to do. Slowly, somebody told him, listen, you know how to use a mobile? He says, yes. So he says, you can help people with linking their Aadhaar cards to bank accounts. You can help people trying to figure out whether the panis, the land records, are what it is supposed to be, and you can help do a printout. So he bought a printer, bought a computer, started offering these services, and slowly started thinking like an entrepreneur. He started saying, so what else does my village need? Right? That's when we happened to meet him and said, hey, your village will need mobile recharges, your village will need bank account details to be given to them, cash withdrawal, mini ATMs. There are no ATMs in Sanenahalli, so you may act as a mini ATM. And of course, your village is aspirational. They want to buy stuff on Amazon. So how come you place orders on online catalogs and help your village get onto assisted commerce? Today, Praveen is earning 15,000 rupees in his village by offering a stack of services for the village. Anybody wants to buy a TV, they come and say, I have 10,000 rupees, which TV should I buy, right? And he says a friend of his recently came and told him about a pension yojana which nobody knew in the village. And he was telling me with pride and sadness that he got one of his friends to sign up for his pregnant wife under the Atal pension yojana, and unfortunately the wife passed away during the childbirth. But he says that act of mine is got this newborn 8.5 lakhs from the government, because the pension scheme allows that kind of money to be paid. What drives me in all of this, examples that I narrate with you, from our experiences, and this I see happening all in 3,000 villages that we work in, is how much access that we take for granted doesn't exist. How there are no jobs. Sitting here in this beautiful campus, I know that the top thing on many of our minds is, okay, I'll graduate and I'll get a job. Praveen graduated from an ITI, there are no jobs. So where are the jobs? That's the new economy reality, that there are no jobs. The job challenge, in my mind, is the single largest challenge that the country faces today. And if we don't address that in a holistic way, we are going to have blood on the streets, right? So how do you then solve for the jobs challenge in Praveen's story? You know, how do you create sustainable jobs in his village? He says, I want to stay with my parents. I want to stay in my with my grandparents. I want to be here. This is my Janmabhoomi. I want to be here, right? Two is vanishing away with the notion of jobs is also the notion of security. In every survey we do, 9 out of 10 kids outside of Bangalore, you ask them, what do you want to be? They say, I want a government job, right? Where are the government jobs? It's far from being in plenty, and it's not going to feed everybody, right? So how do you then create the security that comes along with a job? For a Praveen, he falls ill, his monthly savings are gone like this, right? So how do you create safety nets for folks like that? I was asking Praveen, so what do you want to be? He was saying, hey, you know what? There is no computer browsing center in my village. What if I put 5 computers and start doing online education? I hear that a lot of content is available online. What if I were to provide that online? Somebody told him about telemedicine. He says, what if I provision people to get access to a doctor from my village? And by doing so, he says, 5 of my friends can earn 5,000 rupees a month. Praveen is thinking as an entrepreneur. But in here in the city, the moment you say an entrepreneur, we only think of unicorns, God knows how many horns, right? But we don't tend to think of a Praveen as an entrepreneur. And I believe the country, what we need today is millions of Praveens who are being forced. Praveen became what we call as a necessity entrepreneur. He didn't know what to do, but slowly he evolved and started looking at opportunities and moved from being a necessity entrepreneur to an opportunity entrepreneur, right? And Praveen's dream is now saying, listen, in my village, by doing 10 things, I can create incomes for 5 more people, right? What India needs is an upsurge of entrepreneurs like this. We call them as mass entrepreneurs. We need them in every village, every taluka, every district where entrepreneurs can thrive, create 5-10 jobs each. And to my mind, the 100 million job challenge that we face in the country today for the next 10 years cannot be solved by X 100 entities trying to create 100,000 jobs each, but can be solved by 10 million entrepreneurs who can go on to create 10 jobs each, right? So to do that, we need to do a lot of reimagining, right? We need to reimagine our education systems, right? Why should a Praveen spend 16 years by passing 10th and doing an ITI when there's no currency for that education, right? Praveen has learned. So when I asked him, what have you learned? Learning is such an alien word. He said, no, I haven't learned anything. But I said, hey, you learned how to take land records. You learned how to link Aadhaar to bank accounts. You learned how to make people withdraw ATM. Oh, he says, I never realized that's all learning. But learning is enabling an income for Praveen, right? So how do we reimagine our learning systems? How do we reimagine education to be able to create more entrepreneurs, right? Second, how do we reimagine jobs itself? How do we reimagine digital? I think with everything that's happening around the digital space, the innovation that we can really drive in our villages, the opportunity is far, far larger than in the cities, right? A few years ago, we did a very interesting experiment. One of my entrepreneurs from Mandya was pestering me. He had come to Bangalore, he had come to this Forum Mall. He was enamored by the mall, and he kept asking me, in my village, why can't there be a mall? And I was trying to explain to him, hey, in a village of 5,000 people, which nutcase will put a mall in your town, and how does the economics of it work? And finally, after some fifth rebuttal, he said, hey, you guys are technology people. You think of something that you can do. And that's when the penny dropped, saying, hey, if the rural consumers can't come to the mall, why can't the mall go to them? So we actually put out a virtual reality mall. We actually built a VR app. Had this guy with a VR headset, and it's like the old time bioscope. So this guy went around the village saying, hey, you want to experience a zone where you can look at tractors, televisions, insurance services, here is a mall. Massive hit, right? People just loved the experience. They said, we have never seen anything like this. So how do you reimagine technology to play a pivotal role in A, increasing consumer experiences, and more importantly, increasing incomes for youth there? How do we reimagine all of us as the ecosystem, educational institutions, governments, public sector entities, private sector organizations, civil society organizations, how do we enable mass entrepreneurship to thrive than to stifle it? Right? Today, as an entrepreneur, I'm telling you, if I were to say, hey, I'm complying with 5 rules, I can be thrown 10 other rules and said you're in violation of these 10 rules, right? So how do we ease the ease of doing business for an entrepreneur on the street, right? Today, most of the ease of doing business indices are largely for, you know, the, as I said, the luxury entrepreneurs, right? What do we do for the guy on the street? How do we as a system enable that that ecosystem to thrive and get out of the way in many times and ensure that their spirits aren't hindered? And lastly, how do we reimagine a society where a kid is being taught or being schooled into entrepreneurial mindsets and skills without being told that, hey, you're an entrepreneur or you're not an entrepreneur? Many years ago, when mathematics was democratized, it was only taught that it is a subject for the elite till it got democratized, and now mathematics is a skill that every kid needs. How do we make entrepreneurial skills and mindsets a part of every kid's learning process? Whether you're an entrepreneur or not, it's important for the youth to start thinking entrepreneurially. The last point I want to make is many times we think we will stop at just being and ensuring just economic fencing and make sure that your livelihoods are created. I personally abhor the word term livelihood. None of us will ever go to an IBM or a Microsoft and say, hey, I've applied for my livelihood. We want a job with growth, with income growth, with the pride, with the titles and all that stuff. But more importantly, in the villages when I've asked, what do you want? Most often I hear our entrepreneurs, our youth in the village are saying, help me do something for my village, right? We don't get healthcare access in our villages. We don't get to hear of many government schemes that are supposedly for our benefit. Access is broken. If somebody is ill, it takes us 3 hours to get to the nearest hospital. There are no schools. Most entrepreneurs, most youth want to be change makers. And I think we have to recognize that if you can aspire and soar for the skies where every youth is a change maker, the entrepreneurial skills and therefore the ability to change the way we live in this world, and the ability for us to reimagine stuff will be far, far greater, right? So in my worldview, can we imagine a world where every youth is an empowered youth, where there's oodles of confidence, where every empowered youth is an entrepreneur who can create incomes for 5-10 people, and every such entrepreneur is a change maker, who then is not just fending for himself or herself and the family, but is also impacting the society. Into that heaven of freedom, my father, let my country awake. Thank you.